Good afternoon, people. So here's what happens when you start clustering speakers on the basis of certain attributes. You put Anis and me in the same session. Okay. All right. I need to give credits at first. Slide deck was made by my boss. He likes to doodle, so you'll see a lot of those up there. That's right, people. My boss made my slides. You should all be so lucky. The truth is that we did the same talk at MachineCon, and then we did it together, so we made the slides. But there's a more interesting story in it. Okay, so start with introductions. I am Ramsu. I go by Ramasubramanian Sundararajan. I usually go by Ramsu because who'd want to say that whole name out loud, right? Okay, so I head AI for Cartesian Consulting. We are an analytics firm based out of India. We're headquartered in Bombay. We have an office in Bangalore and Delhi. We also have an office in Singapore. My colleague Deepa is out there. Please do reach out to us and we'd be glad to talk to you offline. We're very glad to be here. This is the second edition of MachineCon. We were there at the first. We really enjoyed talking to the people out there. We heard a lot. We learned a lot. And here's the reason why. We're all analytics folks, right? We're all people who use data for decision making. So a focused data science talk or a focused data science talk will resonate very well with a whole bunch of people. But the nice thing is, at the same time, you get diversity of perspective. There are people here who are in the business of analytics. There are people here who use analytics for business. There are also people here who teach analytics, which means on pretty much the same topic, you get very, very diverse perspectives. And we would have seen that even during the Q&As and during the talks here. So it's fantastic, right? Now let's just dive into it a little deeper, right? Because we use data for decision making so often, we have this laser focus on, listen, how do I use this data well? How do I make decisions well, right? So we're very focused very often on building and tuning models. What happens then is that sometimes we miss out on the pieces that are just out of sight. I don't mean this as a motherhood and apple pie sort of statement. Most people here understand that there's a business context to making decisions. But at my heart, I'm still a techie. So a lot of what you're going to see here is going to sound philosophical, but there's also a technical aspect to it that I will try and elaborate upon as we go along. So what happens is that you tend to look at very specific things in your data. So what we're going to do is we're going to share some experience here about cases where we looked at and we said, oh, this is something that we hadn't thought of, right? So I speak for my organization because all of these came during our experience of building certain products and solutions for our clients. Okay, so this is not the royal we, this is the organizational we. Okay, all right. Let's focus on customer a little bit because that's something that resonates with most people, right? So it's a fairly prevalent use case, so it's a good place to start. So we have about 6 experiences where we pulled back and we got a glimpse of the larger portion of the board. Okay, and that's essentially what we're going to try and talk about. Okay, now the thing is, for a long time this was a very predictable sort of business. So how did you do analytics? And this is still true largely, right? So you have a business mission. So you sit down, you look at your data, you build a model, you build rules, you make a list, you go target customers, right? You do a campaign, you measure lift, you kind of get a sense of how that goes. Most people in this room can do it in their sleep, right? We all know this, it's very, very simple, right? Where it starts getting complicated is when you start asking yourself, I have all these models, am I trusting them a bit too much? Have you guys felt that? Like, do I just trust my models a bit too much? Because when you think about it, here's what happens, right? A model is an abstraction of reality, okay? And reality is messy as heck, okay? As George Box once very famously said, all models are wrong, some models are useful, right? So what happens is, reality is tough. You're just taking a part of that, creating this clean little box with nice lines, and you're living inside that box, and you don't want to look outside past a point, because it's just nice inside. So here's what happens, right? We tend to think of our environments as being very data rich, but that's a term with a lot of nuance. Let me give you a simple example. Let's say I have data about one store, let's say sales data about one store for 10 years. And let's say the gentleman here has sales data about 520 stores for a week. We both have the same amount of data, but what we have are entirely different beasts. What I can do with my data, he cannot. What he can do with his data, I cannot, right? These are very, very different things, okay? And that's just when you consider the aspect of broad and shallow versus narrow and deep. There's the other aspect, which is that when we go back to customer level data, you don't know the exact same amount of data about all your customers. See, when you think about hyper-personalization in terms like segment of one and so on, which are so much in currency, the dream they're sold on is we know our customer inside out. Fact is, that for a lot of your customers, there ain't much on the inside, you ain't looking on the outside either, right? It's very limited, okay? And it's not immediately obvious. So we have a lot of data as a statement that requires a lot of unpacking, okay? So what happens then when you have data about customers that are at various levels of depth? What happens is that over time, your models tend to favor the people about whom you know a little more. If you talk about it in a marketing context and you want to cross-sell new products to somebody, you're more likely to start looking at people whom you have more data about, because those are the ones that you are more confident about being able to do something with. What that leads to is what we call tyranny of the top decile. So imagine that you have a bunch of products and each product manager has a mission, and that person goes out and builds a model and then generates a list and then goes ahead. What happens is that each person trying to build a model and focusing on a mission is going around with a flashlight and trying to find those customers they want. That flashlight can illuminate about 10% of their customer base, which is nice, except in a lot of cases, the same 10% have 10 different flashlights pointed at them. The other 90% are comfortably sitting in the dark, right? So A, those guys aren't getting anything relevant, and B, these 10% just want you to shut up because you're talking to them all the time about all kinds of products, right? So it's sort of a very asymmetric scenario. So let's say, if you want to solve this problem, the first thing you need to do is recognize it, right? So let's just talk about data sparsity for a moment. Now, I'll take a simple example, right? Which is, this is in the retail context. Let's say a guy goes into a store and buys a blue shirt. Okay, one transaction, blue shirt. Every working age male in the history of working age males has a blue shirt. You can count them in this room. Okay, and then those who aren't wearing a blue shirt have one in their wardrobe. I'm fairly certain of it, right? So what has that told you? It's told you nothing, right? Nearly nothing. You can't take that one transaction and start saying, listen, this guy's life is all about blue. What you need is an ability to balance two things. One is clarity about your customer's preferences, and two, robustness about your own knowledge. Okay. So if he has one blue shirt, 100% of his transactions are blue. That's clarity, but there's no robustness behind it. If this person, on the other hand, has come to your store 6 times and pretty much bought the same shade of shirt, and he's told you something. He's told you that he's the Obama or the Mark Zuckerberg type who just wants to go into the wardrobe and pick out one shirt and wear it and not make any decisions about clothing for the rest of the day, right? Then you know something. Or if that person has bought, let's say, a purple polka dot shirt, well, that's not common, right? That tells you something. So you can contextualize what information you have and sort of begin to understand it. So if you were to think of it probabilistically, right? I told you I'm a techie, so I'm going to throw a little bit of math in there. The way you think about it is, let's imagine that the way you're modeling it is to not just maintain a list of what people buy, but let's say you maintain a color distribution. Let's assume that we're going to use 4 colors, red, blue, green, and yellow. All of those are fictitious. Magenta and all, I don't think it's a real color. Okay, so you've got 4 colors, guy buys a blue shirt. You start off saying all colors are uniformly probable. Okay, moment the guy buys a blue shirt, you bump up blue a little bit, you bump down the other 3 colors, but that's all you do. You don't bump this up to 100% and bump the rest down to 0, right? So you've accounted for the fact that you have sparse data. 6-7 transactions down the line, you may have a much clearer picture, right? So simply a change in the way you model customer preferences, where you account for the fact that there may be sparsity of data, allows you to sort of model clarity versus robustness better, right? And if you start contextualizing this, saying, instead of blue, if what he bought was purple, which is not a common color to buy, then I'll bump it up a little more than I would have if I bought blue, that tells you something. If you add context to it, saying festive season purchases are different from normal purchases, I add more context to it. So I can start doing this better as I start exploring methods outside of the standard ambit of methods I use, right? The big realization to start off with is, you don't know as much of the customer about the customer as you think you do. Start recognizing and modeling that uncertainty into your processes, right? Now let's take an instance where you're still going with this business of, I need to make this mission work. So what happens? You take a bunch of customers and you're trying to sell them a product, right? What happens then is, because your list needs to be large enough or you need to target the right number of people, you tend to start offering this product to people who don't really want it, right? Like if you're selling an egg beater to Humpty Dumpty. So what do you want to do then? You want to change your POV, right? This is still standard. This most people still understand. So supposing you inverted the POV and you said, rather than figure out which customer this product is suited to, I changed the POV to ask myself which product this customer is suited to, then a different bunch of methods open up, right? So we're all familiar with recommender systems. So we're pretty comfortable with that idea yet, where instead of product first, if you become customer first, what happens? Right? So you think collaborative filtering, market basket analysis, just offer the most popular product, all of that is true. But here's the thing, the world isn't binary even there. You can't say that it's either product first or customer first. You've got to have both POVs. Because even if you have a recommender system running in your backend and you're doing all of these things, there are times when you need to liquidate stock. There are times when a store is introducing a new line of clothing and wants to talk about that. You can't say that there's only one mission in the universe and that's to just find the right product for each customer. Sometimes you got to do the other one, which means your penny dropping moment is not that you need to shift POVs, but to realize A, there's no single best approach and there's no single best POV. Even look at recommender systems for a moment, right? So what's the best example you can think of a recommender system out there? What's the example that everybody would quote? Netflix, Amazon, right? Those are pull systems, right? A guy goes to an Amazon site and he's getting recommendations. There are somewhere in the region of 130 pieces of real estate on a web page on Amazon for them to sell products to you. If you're an offline retailer, the sharp end of the stick for you is 140 characters in a text message. So that means I have to start off assuming that there's no single best approach. I can't say that for everybody I'm just going to sell the best seller, or I'm going to use user-based collaborative filtering, or only item-based collaborative filtering. Maybe different things work for different people. Right. More importantly, sometimes context might mean that the same thing doesn't even work for everybody, for a particular person, the same way all the time. There are times when you'll just go with what's popular. There are times when you'll go with what you like. Right. So things change, which means you need to have algorithms that sort of account for this. So when we started off looking at this problem of how do you do recommenders and so on, our first thought was, yeah, we'd ensemble it. Then we realized that probability still plays a part. Uncertainty still plays a part. So we've started evolving in the direction of things like multi-arm bandits or contextual multi-arm bandits, where what you want to do is to account for the possibility that you have various options. There's context that determines which option might be better at any point in time, but that's still an estimate. There's still uncertainty around it. The less you know about the customer, the more uncertain you are. And you got to account for that uncertainty and allow for the possibility that something else works better. Right. So you sort of mix things up a little bit. You don't necessarily always go with the winner. You don't subscribe to the gospel of winner take all. Right. For instance, supposing you had three different choices. Let's say the first choice gave you a probability of 0.45, the second was 0.4, and the third one was 0.15. Yeah, the first one won, but not by much. It won the electoral college, not the votes, right? So, or the other way around, depending on which side of the spectrum you're on, right? So then what happens is you realize that you need to bring probabilistics into it. So we realized that, you know, exploring methods like contextual multi-arm bandits really help us getting this right. Like I said, these sound like motherhood and apple pie statements, but there is tech, because behind nearly every messy real world problem is a very nice research problem. And a bunch of people have put their best minds to it to try and solve them. So there's a whole raft of methods out there that we typically don't consider, because somewhere in there we're hardwired to think that winner takes all. The moment we step out of that little box, we find that a lot of interesting stuff come out there. Right. So that's one instance where we said, listen, don't put all your faith in one model. Right. The second one is sort of linked to this, which has to do with inbreeding. Again, let me take an example. So let's say you're running a campaign, right? You want to figure out who's most likely to respond to a product. You pulled a list, you targeted these guys. 6 months down the line, you got to do this again. You realize I need to update this. This is more recent data. So you're going back to try and figure out whom did I target with this product, who responded. The trouble is now your historical data is built on people whom you already targeted on the basis of your previous model. So you've introduced a layer of bias that keeps propagating again and again, right? So that's one example. There's a whole bunch of others where models will essentially inbreed, and once you have a certain mindset, you tend not to step out of that box. So one thing it's very useful to do is to bake in experimentation in your entire philosophy, right? Your model will not recommend anything you will try it before. So I said we build two products, right? One of those is a marketing communications optimizer, right? So we help people craft marketing communication. Like, we started off with a simple question like, how do you make an email subject line crafted in such a way that it's likely to be opened? Because at the end of the day, he doesn't open the email, he doesn't see the discount, he's not going to come to your store, right? So when we started doing that, we started looking at how people were sending their emails and how it corresponded to the open rate and so on. But at some point we realized that's still a very inbred sort of system. There's a point after which there's no variety in how an organization communicates, whereas there are 10 others out there who are doing very interesting and funky things. So you need to start exposing your own decision makers to all of that so that they start mixing it up a little. You actually have to go against your own grain and tell them, don't trust my model entirely. Let me show you what else people are doing, and it's okay to take some of those things, and it's okay to lose a little in the beginning so that you can win a lot. Which means you bake in this entire philosophy of experimentation into your decision processes, and it has got to be constant. It can't be something that you just do once in a while. I ran an A-B test today, that's it. For the next 6 months, I'm not going to think about it. No, it's got to be constant. Okay, you got to keep losing a little, except there are ways of doing that reasonably smartly with things like Thompson sampling that allow you to do it in a manner where you might start off assuming that all options are equally good, but over time you tend to emphasize a little more on the options that work better and a little less on the options that work worse. Remember I said more and less. I didn't say entirely and not at all. Right, again, always keep in mind that you're dealing most often in social systems. We're not dealing with the physical laws of the universe. We're dealing with people. So this very pesky little thing called free will, which means that A, environments change, people change, and people just do what the hell they feel like. Right, which means you've got to account for it, and you've got to keep experimenting so that you know what works. So experimentation becomes critical. Otherwise, even if you did solve for ROI, and ROI is something that keeps coming up, right? Even if you solved for ROI at one point in time, you don't know whether or not you're going to keep getting that kind of ROI over time, right? So when we did this, we came to this other little realization, which is, this is sort of a game, right? So what you want to do, your win is a customer comes and transacts, let's say, okay? So what are your moves? Your visible moves are the campaigns you do, the communications you send, and so on. What are your customers' moves? Your customers' moves are the data trail they leave, the transactions they do. You want to make your moves in such a way that eventually the customer comes and transacts, right? Now what that means is you're going to have to think of the game as a sequence. So let's take the game analogy a little further. Let's say you're playing chess. Clean board, you got an opponent in front of you. You move your king's pawn ahead two squares. You get up and say checkmate. What happens? You get laughed out of the room. You got to play the whole game, which means a single campaign or a single communication is not the one that leads to a win. You got to make a series of moves in order to eventually come to the win. This is reasonably well understood in the digital world, where people talk about things like last touch attribution and multi-touch attribution, where they say, let's say I served up ads on Google and on Facebook and on YouTube and so on, and somebody came and clicked on the Facebook ad. Excellent. Okay, but you can't attribute all of that success to that click. You want to attribute it to the possibility that the guy had seen the ad three times before and then eventually clicked on this. So you start thinking of the win in terms of sequences. Now this is somewhat well understood in the digital space, although I don't think perfectly well modeled yet. In the marketing space or in the CRM space, hardly. Right? People still think about the victory of a campaign in terms of that campaign, or the effectiveness of a communication in terms of that tranche of communications. They don't think in terms of the sequence of communications that went before it in order to get the guy to transact. So when you start thinking like that, you realize that sequences matter, not an individual move. So that opens up a whole raft of methods, because when you look at what people talk about when they do game playing so on right now, what do people talk about in the AI space? They talk about things like reinforcement learning. Okay. In the traditional optimization space, people talk about things like dynamic programming. So there's a whole raft of methods out there that allow you to model sequences, except they never got into the game so far because we kept thinking in terms of that campaign, that action. The moment you think in terms of sequences, these other methods open up, these other ways of modeling things open up. Okay. And that makes the whole problem interesting. right? And when you do that, there's an additional aspect to consider, which is you want to get ROI out of the various moves you make, which means you have a limited number of moves to make. You can't assume that you have unlimited moves. If you have only a limited number of moves, that also means that you have to consider inaction as a move. Not making a move, keeping quiet sometimes, is also part of that cadence, and you want to account for that, right? So that's also important, and that's very counterintuitive, because people always think about communication as the thing to do. Not communicating is not something they account for, right? And that becomes important. But while you do this, again, we bump up against our old enemy called bias propagation. Why? If you're going to learn how to do this by way of your historic data, and you've had a historic sequence of, you know, communicating with the customer every Monday morning, that's all your model has got to see. So again, any of these works only if you explore, only if you constantly bake in experimentation. Only then will you know which sequences work. Lose a little so that you can win a lot. Deferred rewards are a reality. Think beyond your next action. That was our other big insight. So when we did all of this thought started going into our product, which we call Solus. Okay. The website is solus.ai. It's reasonably easy to remember. Please do go visit the website and do reach out to us in case you want to talk to us about this. It's a hyper-personalized targeting solution that accounts for a number of factors. Right. So as we shifted into solutions mode, see, we used to be a delivery-focused firm, which means somebody came to us with a problem, we solved it. The moment we shifted into solution mode, we realized a few new things that hadn't popped up on the board earlier. One is solutions don't exist in a vacuum. They need to play nice with other people. They need to play nice with other systems. Okay. Let me give you examples of how we saw this. One is that people will sit alongside and make decisions. Some of these are very tactical decisions. For instance, supposing you're dealing with a QSR firm, right? And you're building a hyper-personalized targeting solution that does all of this. And let's say that guy just wants to send out a blast to people living in a particular neighborhood saying, listen, there's a promotion at this mall. You come here and you get whatever. Like 3/4 of the pizza is on you. The remaining quarter is on us or whatever. Right? So let's say he wants to send out a campaign. That's tactical, right? And he wants to be able to do that. And people will always have reasons to make tactical decisions alongside the automated decisions that you're making. There's always going to be that manual override part. It won't always run on autopilot. The other part is that when you look at your sequence of decisions that you're making in order to run a particular campaign or a particular decision, there are decisions in there that are manual, there are decisions in there that are automated. And you've got to account for that as well. So what that means is you have to start asking yourself the following question, which is, can I discriminate between what I cannot deal with because they have to be tactical and they have to deal with what comes up suddenly? And how much of those can I look at, step back and say, these are things that I can automate. These are things that I can sort of account for. The moment you make that realization, another raft of techniques and another raft of things open up. There's a term that people use when they describe biological systems or neural networks. It's called the stability plasticity dilemma. The easiest way to explain it is through the following analogy. Let's say you go jogging every morning. One morning it rains. So what are you going to do? Stay at home. But the next day you still put on your running shoes and you jog. Okay. Few days later you start getting pain in your knees. So then what do? You shift to the cross trainer. So your behavior had to be stable enough to account for that little blip, which was rain in the morning, but still plastic enough to account for the fact that now physically you may not be suited for running. You have to shift to another form of exercise. Systems have to do that. When we build a box, we tend to think of the box as one stable thing. They can't do that, right? There will be people making decisions alongside it, and you got to account for that and see how much of those can I now incorporate. So we started asking ourselves very interesting questions there. For instance, I spoke about Kite, our marketing communications organization, right? So that's the decision people make at the end. You pull a list, you do all of that, then you're sending an email. That's your sharp end of the stick. If the guy doesn't open the email, nothing happens. If that part is entirely manual, we asked ourselves a question, is it possible to bring some science into it? Can we break down, for instance, marketing communication into what the email is about or what the message is about and how it is about it? And can we figure out how much influence the mechanism of expression has in terms of whether or not it's effective? So you start bringing science into things that were manual, right? So it's always necessary for any system to also look around and see what else are people doing, either to bypass it or before or after it, okay? And how much of that can a system evolve to sort of incorporate, okay? So that became our other insight, right? The second part of the same insight is it needs to play with well with other systems. Now we all understand this concept of silos, Right. They're all familiar with it. We're familiar with the organization, reasons why it happens. There's another aspect to silos that we learned over time, which is what happens within a silo is sometimes not obvious outside of it. Okay. For instance, let's say you're a bank, you've got a division, you've got like say five products, and you've got somebody essentially building a logistic regression model to pull out a list and then target people with product one. You got another guy targeting with product two, product three, and so on, right? Some young whippersnapper who did data science and machine learning came in, sat in one of these silos and said, I'm going to replace this logistic regression model with a random forest model. There's another guy who was his classmate who joined a different silo, went there and built, let's say, a support vector machine model. Third data scientist went and built a neural network model somewhere. Excellent. These silos are now producing scores. They used to work independently, but then another fellow came in and said, listen, we need to combine all of these and just send one offer based on which product is best suited for this customer. I said, yeah, okay, we have scores, we'll give it to you, you take them. Okay. Here's the trouble with it, right? You've got scores coming out of these various models. These scores all are between 0 and 1. The higher the score, the more likely the customer is to respond. So it looks like a probability, it quacks like a probability, but maybe it isn't a probability. What a random forest model produces looks like what a logistic regression model produces. It's between 0 and 1. Higher is better. But that doesn't necessarily mean it can be treated like a probability. So if the random forest model is producing a score of 0.3, and an SVM model sitting somewhere else is producing a score of 0.4. I can't compare the two and say 0.4 is better than 0.3. They may not be comparable in the first place. You're first going to have to calibrate it and figure out how to bring them to the same platform. Okay. I've been guilty of doing this mistake. Okay. After a point, once you've sent out your model scores into the void, you don't really control what people do with it. So very weird things begin to happen because people will start putting them together in very unholy ways. Right. So then there's this realization that things that are sometimes supposed to work together don't. And there are other examples. For instance, when you build recommender systems, let's say I did all of this hyper-personalized targeting and I said, I need to recommend, say, a checked shirt to somebody. I sent out the message, guy goes to the store, they're all out of checked shirts. So if I didn't also bring inventory into my system, if I didn't bring that knowledge into my system, I'm probably making decisions that simply don't work. Right. That's a very simple example. But at any point, you need to sort of realize that this can happen. If you build a segmentation model that needs to be used in real time by a system that only accepts if-then rules, then I can't build segmentation models that are based on, for instance, k-means clustering. Because this happens. Right. You say segmentation, the Pavlovian response is clustering. You say clustering, the Pavlovian response is k-means. You've done all of that, except at this end of the system, you've got something that only accepts if-then rules, and k-means doesn't know what to do. Right. We run into that. So you have all of these things where you need to sort of understand that systems need to speak to one another, and that problem is actually tougher than it sometimes sounds. Okay. The next thing we realize is that when we build all of these very complicated systems, you're making decisions at scale for a lot of people, is it interpretable? The term interpretability itself, for lack of a better word, requires interpretation. If it's a model, we tend to think of interpretation in terms of variable importance. We tend to think of it in terms of, does it have a functional form that is clear? But in systems, it's a slightly different thing. When you're building systems, you're asking yourself the question, do I have a line of sight from what I know about a customer to what decision I'm making? Can I build that chain? Okay. So systems are complicated by nature. You're doing a lot of stuff inside. So do you have a sense of how, starting from what you know about a customer, you're eventually able to reason through to the decision you're making? And that doesn't mean you have to be able to unwrap every piece or unwrap the whole thing in terms of one functional form that you completely understand. It's an ability to understand how your various decisions along the way work, right? You have to be able to attribute things to the various components in there. You're building a list, you're running a model, you're then sending out communication. What is the effectiveness of each of these components? So what that means is you can't start thinking of your system itself as a box. You have to think of it as a series of widgets that you're placing together in some form. And you're going to have to figure out, A, is there an intuition behind what that widget itself is doing? And can I explain that? Okay. And B, can I now experiment by maybe turning some parts of the widget off, some parts of the widget on, swapping something out with a different widget, maybe just swapping it out with something completely random, and can I figure out what happens? So as I said earlier, experimentation needs to be baked in. Testing needs to be baked in. Okay, not just to avoid the trap of winner take all, but also sometimes to realize that various components have varying levels of effectiveness that you need to be able to constantly validate. Okay, that becomes critical when you're building these systems. Okay, so finally, the sixth insight is a little away from all of this, okay, but we still feel fairly important. Okay, something that I think we're only slowly beginning to equip ourselves with, which is, what are the ethics of what we do? See, like I said, we're data folks, right? So we tend to believe that more data is good. We want a lot of data, we want the data that the other person has. All of that is true. Okay, but what that sometimes leads to is, if you have the data, it's very tough to resist the temptation to not to use it, right? If you have it, you're going to use it, you're going to put it in a model. But what that can sometimes lead to is, you might deny a service level to somebody on the basis of their postal code. Is that the right thing to do? It's fair to sometimes step back and ask yourself that question. This was, I think, touched upon earlier in the panel discussion as well. Some of it has to do with what? Regulations around privacy. Some of it has to do with federation. Some of it also has to do with simply the question of whether certain kinds of data, whether or not you have access to it, you should be using, right? Because this happens in increments, right? You get a tiny bit more data and you start using it, and then a little bit more and a little bit more. And before you've noticed it, you've crossed well past that line that you originally should have drawn for yourself, right? And if you think of these things as constraints, and that's what happens, right? Because when you have the data, not using it feels like a constraint, right? Then it's a very difficult question. But at some point, we need to probably step back as data scientists and as decision makers who use data. And we need to tell ourselves the following thing, that if the ethics don't kick in, somebody else is going to come and do it for us, right? If we don't draw those lines, the law will, okay? Then it's very tough to deal, okay? It's always better to sort of step back a little early and be preemptive about it, and sort of understand that we're building these models, but we were building systems. When we spoke about looking at the whole board, we were still looking at the whole board within the organization, within the fact that there's a customer POV and a product POV and all of that. But an even larger expansion of the board is to realize that we all live in this larger society where we have a responsibility, right? And that should also, to some extent, drive what we do. So to summarize very quickly, there's no single strategy. Winner doesn't take all. Try new things, mix things up a bit, experiment constantly. Sequences win. A single move doesn't win. You can't win in a single move. Understand the sequences. Play well with others, other people, other systems. Understand the cost and the value of every move you make and every little piece of the puzzle that you put in place. And finally, above all, play fair. That's all I've got. Thank you. Questions?
Already past lunchtime. So you talk about like one model is not the right answer. So we should definitely talk about experimentation. So in your experience, when you talk to clients, how do you manage to convince them? Because sometimes one model has been entrenched, and then every year you're just refreshing that model with new data and just keep on doing that. So that's my question.
The short answer, to quote Orson Welles, is with great difficulty. Okay, but one way of getting around it is to essentially sort of explain the intuition behind the various models and explain what assumptions they rest on. See, every model rests on some assumption about what works. So I'll give you an example of where we're doing this with recommender systems. Okay. So if I look at recommender systems, you have a bunch of philosophies. The simplest way to recommend something is just recommend what is selling right now, right? Another way of doing it is an item-centric way, which is to say customers who bought this also bought that. Okay. The third way to recommend is to say people like you also bought this other thing. The fourth way to do it is to say something like, if you like this, you would have also liked this other thing, right? Which is content centric. So you go all these methods. Now, very often when we have this conversation with an offline retailer, it's very easy for us to pull up something like Amazon and say, they probably do all of this and they have enough real estate to do it. You don't have that luxury. Now you're going to have to choose. When you place it in that intuitive context, at some point people realize, I don't know how to choose. right? Then you tell them, okay, maybe you have a layer. Okay. Then you tell them that, listen, this is not going to constantly work. So we'll have to show, for instance, instances where it doesn't work. Okay. Then people begin to understand that you do need to fail a little. Okay. I'm not sure if that answers your question entirely, but it is a very difficult question to get answered either.
I understand that, but thanks. I think it was a good answer.
Yes.
Hi, I'm Ravi from great presentation. So you talked in the beginning about uncertainty when you're talking about recommender system.
Correct.
How do we model uncertainty, and how does it change my action or my recommendation, basically?
So, two things. So you can bring uncertainty into how you model customer preferences themselves, okay? Where there are mechanisms to model customer preferences in either a Bayesian manner or in a neural network sort of way that allow you to consider that what you know about the customer only accounts for so much of what you need to know, okay? Which is where I spoke about, for instance, if the guy buys a blue shirt, you just pump up color preference on blue a little bit, but the others not so much. And if those preferences themselves go into how you recommend stuff, okay, then those places where you're uncertain, your model will not throw up a great recommendation. Okay. And as long as you keep in mind that you're uncertain and you maintain that as well, that information as well, it's easy. Right. For instance, if you know that your distribution is not very skewed towards one color or one brand or one kind of clothing, you already know that and can bake it into how much confidence you have on any recommendation that is based on it. Right. So if it's a content-based recommender that says this is what the customer likes, therefore this is what I'm going to recommend, that content-based recommender can be given a lower weightage if you already know that the data that's going into it has a lot of entropy in it. Okay. So there are quantitative methods to model that, and we can sort of discuss this in further detail offline. Okay. The second is, again, experiment, which is you don't necessarily have to pick the winning model at a particular point in time. You can say that if one model seems to be, like if I were to normalize the probability of success of some three different recommender systems, okay, and add them all up to one, and let's say the winner got a 0.45 and the next one got a 0.4 and the third got a 0.15, I might say that with a 0.45 probability, I'll pick the winner. So it's baked into how you make the decision. Now, if the first model was a clear winner, most of the time you would pick it. Like if it was a 0.8 versus a 0.1.1, 8 out of 10 times that you picked out a random number, you would have picked the winning model. But you always have that little room for what is left. So you can sort of bake that into how you do it. Again, a very specific answer to a very broad and difficult question, but I'd be happy to have a longer conversation with you offline on how we could do this in other contexts. Yes.
Just following to discussion we are having, right? Different models,
yes.
Pick one model, but we can always take output from different models, like what we call ensemble.
Yeah, correct. Models. Even ensembling, what happens is, so a random forest, for instance, is an ensemble. There are other ensembles. Even ensembling, what happens is you still pick the winner, right?
Okay.
What I'm sort of talking about is that you do still build ensembles, and there are many ways of building it. You can have them vote, you can have a stacking layer on top that figures out whom a particular model is best suited to. You can do all of that, but at the end of the day, you're still sort of, I mean, very often we have this mindset that says pick the winner.
True.
Okay. Even when you build ensembles, there has to be a layer on top that says hold on. It's possible that even the ensemble says this is the winner, but maybe it's not a very clear winner. And there needs to be room for other things, especially because we're building models in social systems that constantly evolve.
True. But one question I always have this, right? I'm not a data scientist, I'm more data translator. So
okay.
I use the output of data science to do something on the business side. So the speed is always an important aspect.
Correct.
I mean, we can always play with different models, do this, do that, all those kind of thing. How fast we can see the result is most important.
True.
So what's your view on that? I mean, how we should play around, so that we get the confidence that yes, this is an important tool for us to run the operations or business for that matter.
Or nuanced question with a long answer. I'm going to just touch upon a few aspects.
Yeah,
right?
But I'm sure a lot of people in the room probably have the same question.
I'm going to just touch upon a few aspects that come to mind right away. I'm sure a lot more will come. Okay. One is, there are decisions you make at scale. Okay. You're making decisions for every customer out of a million customers. Speed is critical. There are also decisions that you don't make so often, like whether or not you want to open a store in a particular location. Their speed is not important. Getting it right is more important. Because you can't shut down a store willy-nilly. Right? So depending on the magnitude of the decision and how frequently you're making it, sometimes the extent to which speed matters will vary. Okay, that's one. If speed matters tremendously, like if you're making decisions at scale, you want to get the overall insight right, and after that you proceed. Okay. And even there, one of the things that's happening is that programming or model building has become, for lack of a better term, gentrified. It's become easier for us to plug in a library and do some of these things, try out a new algorithm and so on. So it goes back to the ability to build in a structure that allows for ensembling, that allows for a new model to be plugged in and taken out, right? Think of the philosophy behind how people build, for instance, Hadoop and HDFS systems, where they said you have commodity hardware that if it goes in the blink, I'm not going to sit down, get a technician to replace it, repair it. I'm just going to pull it out and put a new box in there, right? As modeling becomes a little more easy, when the ability to build a model and create this little runtime object that you can plug in becomes more and more easy because the libraries are becoming commoditized, it becomes a little easier to also start thinking in those terms, to say that I can plug in something. Like even with something as simple as item-based collaborative filtering, when we built it for a customer, we found that we had 10 different versions of this. We said we're going to keep plugging it in, pulling it out, see what works, right? So sometimes it also requires that shift in mindset where the first thing you build is a framework that allow you to plug models in and out, okay, and then figure out what works.
Yeah. Thank you.
Yes. We have room for maybe one more.
Yeah. Hey Ramsu, it's a fantastic presentation, and as an analytics guy, we'd all appreciate this particular thing. But what the pushback that we get many times is that in the process of getting hyper-personalized, we have a long laundry list of products.
Correct.
And thereby, the tail becomes too long.
Absolutely.
And in that case, the pushback that we get is that curtail. I don't want to manage so many products. And it becomes very difficult for the last mile sales team to actually understand the products if you go on hyper-personalizing.
Correct.
So in that scenario, the decisions that have been taken by the marketing or the sales or the senior management is that simplify the product, simplify the understanding, concentrate more on communication, realistically make it more thing. So there is a divide that I see that we as an analytics personnel want more personalization, while the people who are decision makers, they're looking for more broad-based, more efficiency in communication. So this dilemma is going to be plaguing the organizations in the near future, till the time analytics really takes over. So in this transition phase, how do you see the overall analytics community making a point that this is time to come and make sure that it finds its way in?
Fair question. I don't think any of you ask easy questions, man. See, guys are a tough audience. Okay, so one way of thinking about it, the way I see it, is component-wise, which is, there are certain components that it's going to be tough to personalize. If we start personalizing products that we offer, like a retailer who's selling somebody else's products has no choice but to maintain that large inventory. Somebody who's designing products, the more complicated it gets, the tougher it gets to maintain. That point is well taken. But when we build it as components, it could well be that there are aspects you can't personalize and aspects you can. You may not personalize the product design, you might just personalize the communication. Okay, and maybe that's all you can do. There are instances where we need to be able to step back and say, listen, the ROI in personalizing this aspect is not good enough. Okay, it's just not worth it. Okay, so it becomes important to think of each of those as a box and say, what's the ROI in getting this gloriously right from a personalization standpoint? And where is it that it makes sense to step back and say, I won't do this? And the other thing to also realize that, let's say I personalized the product but made everything else generic, maybe that doesn't work either, right? So to some extent, this is one of those things where there's not going to be an easy answer. Probably the only message to anybody who's building these large data science products is play well with others and understand what component works best and sort of be honest in being able to understand that, because it becomes very easy to chase after what's cool and ignore what's useful. So that ability to critically discriminate between that for each component of the process and say, here's where I can do something interesting, here's where I cannot. Okay. Partly because this itself doesn't work and partly because it doesn't work well with others, becomes important. Thank you so much.